Welcome to the Dozen Debrief. Today, we're going to be talking about the G-induced loss of consciousness, also known as the G-LOC. Originally, when fighter aircraft started flying, we didn't know what G-LOC was. We didn't know anything about G-induced loss of consciousness. All they knew is that people would faint mid-flight. Back in the Battle of Britain, when the Hurricanes and the Spitfires were fighting against the Germans that were trying to cross the channel, historians said that up to almost 30% of the fatalities were caused from some type of G-induced loss of consciousness. They didn't have a whole lot of systems to fight against it, and they didn't know a whole lot about it, but during those dogfights, a lot of the pilots were passing out, and nobody knew what was causing that. So in order to understand what G-LOC is, first we have to understand what Gs are. So sitting here on the ground right now, I'm pulling one G. What that means is I am my weight times one. So if I weigh 170 pounds, I weigh 170 pounds. As you increase that, as you increase to 2 Gs, 3 Gs, 4 Gs, now you take your weight and you multiply it by that factor. So on a roller coaster, you're pulling 3 Gs, you weigh 200 pounds, now you weigh 600 pounds. In modern fighters, those G-forces go to 7, 8, 9 times the gravitational pull of Earth, meaning that if you weighed 200 pounds and you're pulling 9 Gs, you now weigh 1,800 pounds. So imagine trying to do that in a dogfight where you're looking backwards and trying to see where the adversary is and you're maneuvering in relation to them, pulling those amounts of G's. It's a lot of work, it's a lot of strain on the body. The problem is, as you increase those G-forces, there's more and more pressure that's being applied to the blood that's inside your body, pulling it away from your brain towards your lower extremities. Once you exceed the critical ability for your brain to maintain consciousness, you pass out, and that's called G-LOC. As we move into World War II, people started understanding a little bit more about it, and that's when we started to deal with the physiology of what was causing that and started to come up with systems to counter that, like the modern-day G-suit. All right, so the screen thing I'm wearing here is called a G-suit. This one in particular is an advanced technology anti-gravity suit, what we call it the ATAGS. These ATAGS cover up to 95% of your muscles in the lower extremity. So we have bladders here in the abdomen, bladders in the quad, bladders down here around the calves. And what those do is when we're pulling G's, it pushes air into these bladders and that compresses the legs, compresses the abdomen so that we can hopefully prevent the blood from flowing down into those lower extremities and keep more of the blood in the brain. So when you connect the G-suit to the aircraft, it actually connects through this little hose right here. When this is pushed down, it allows air to flow in. There's also a test button that you push to make sure that the bleed air is coming off of the engine into the G-suit correctly. You generally want to do that before takeoff, before you start pulling a lot of G's. Bleed air is a high pressure air that's coming off of the engine that can be used for a multitude of different things. You can use it for cooling of avionics, you can use it for air conditioning, or in this case, you can use it to fill the bladders of your G-suit. So a lot of people think that a G-suit is kind of an end-all be-all to solving G-LOC problems. The fact is that it's absolutely not. They say that the G-suit, a traditional G-suit, will help your resting G-tolerance or your allowed G-tolerance by about a half G to one G. So if you were gonna pass out at 7 Gs, now you have up to 7.5 or 8 Gs before you pass out, if you're doing everything else the same. With these new ATAG suits, they say that that can go up to 1.5 to 2 Gs, so you get a little bit more protection, but if your resting G tolerance is 3 or 4 Gs, and you're relying exclusively on your G-suit to keep you awake, you're not gonna stay awake very long. You need to stay hydrated, you need to have good muscle strain, and you need to be prepared for it with a good breathing technique as well, in order to keep yourself awake. All right, well that's it for now. This is Duzit signing off. See y'all next time. What else? What is this thing? I actually have no idea what's in these pockets. Haha, these are piddle packs. These are what you pee in because there's no bathroom in the, yeah. All right.